I'm Kevin Jackson. I am a senior research scientist here at the University of Illinois. One of my jobs, besides being a senior research scientist, is being a sports injury monitor specifically for football in the athletic department. Part of that detail is being able to evaluate from a different perspective than athletic trainers and team doctors who are on the field, to give them another set of eyes who are higher up to see things that they may miss and call down to be able to say, hey, we need to evaluate a certain player.
Can we check number 47 is coming to the bench?
Whether it's a foot or toe injury, whether it's an ankle or shoulder injury. But one of the biggest things we want to make sure of, if a person has a head injury or concussion who doesn't show any clinical signs of that they're concussed, but maybe doing certain things that I may notice that we might want to pull them to the side and just evaluate them real quick. Certain things that I look for when I, obviously being a former player, is we try to mask that we've hurt. You know, you have that warrior mentality. When you think about head injuries, a lot of players will grab their face mask a couple of times and they keep grabbing it over and over again. I start evaluating, like, why does he keep grabbing his face mask? Either something's wrong with his helmet or he's trying to shake off that head he just did. Everybody knows what a concussion is. If they see it on the field, a person's knocked out, they think that's what a concussion is. But a mild disruption in brain function is a concussion. Whether you can go back out and function just fine, it still is a mild concussion. And those are some of the things that I had to educate myself on in understanding what a true concussion was, and what I think the world is trying to understand what a true concussion is itself, because the definitions change so many different times. There's several things that can happen after you get a concussion. You can get headaches, sensitivity to light, sensitivity to sound, nausea. It varies between each person, and that's the hard thing about diagnosing a true concussion. It can happen in, you know, volleyball, it can happen in tennis, it can happen in other sports that we just normally don't talk about, even auto car racing, bull riding, cheerleading, you name it, concussions can happen. Think about football, taking constant repetitive hits, but you don't show any clinical signs of a concussion or a head injury. Those are the groups that are more interesting to me, because it's, you know, you look fine, everything looks normal, but if we do any type of brain function test or brain analysis, there may be some disruption that from beginning when you first started compared to now that we may be able to pick up or that we didn't think about before. I played here from 90 to 94 at the University of Illinois as a running back. 20-something years ago, we didn't have all these concussion tests that they have now to test an athlete. So I probably had two or three in my lifetime when I first started playing. We rarely talked about long-term problems with brains. Now that we're starting to see that people are having these constant headaches, memory loss, earlier dementia, earlier Alzheimer's, now people are starting to see that there are some long-term complications with concussions. But where does it start? You know, you can't say because somebody played in the NFL, they had these things. What happened in high school and college that they played these sports? You know, we have 4 or 5 years with these players. We have a certain test we can run on every year to get a better assessment of certain things that's happening within their brains. When a brain injury happens, there's a certain cascade of events that occur. The blood-brain barrier is one of the things that is disrupted. That causes certain things to leak into your blood. If you heard of biomarker research, we shouldn't see them normally in blood. But if we do see those markers being expressed in blood, we obviously know there's an integrity loss in the blood-brain barrier. Brain temperature has been shown to have an effect on concussions and head injuries in animal studies. By cooling can help alleviate some of that problem by bringing the blood-brain barrier back into its intact state so you don't get that leakage. When you play a sport, your brain temperature is elevated from 98 to about 102 degrees. The quicker we can get the brain back down to normal thermia, which is that 98, the quicker the brain can start working on dealing with the injury itself. So we got interested in using a special cooling cap that neurosurgeon John Wong out of Carleton Hospital, Dr. Bill Wilkins, developed. They had a grant from the military to do this cooling device and military personnel. Well, when I saw it, as being a former athlete, it's like, why don't we use these for athletes? Why can't we use it for concussion? And that's where it took off from there, from us being one of the first groups to talk about post-injury being a small intervention, not to get an athlete back on the field faster, but to deal with some of these long-term complications that we've been seeing in with repetitive head hits. This is one of the cooling devices that we use. This is more of what we call it a short-term cooling. What we're interested in this is more of 20, 30 minutes worth of cooling. So after a practice, after an injury, we can put this on the player immediately and they can wear it for 10 to 20 minutes. The main areas that we try to focus on, obviously the frontal lobe here, we try to get here, there's ice packets, as well as the neck region. So this goes all around the back of the neck. And we have a long-term one, which pumps cold water throughout the entire time, which is a more 4 to 5 hours worth of cooling at one time. Well, this is more of a short-term, immediately after an injury. The good thing about this is each player can have one of their own. So they can just take this and put it on any time. They can take it home with them, put it in their freezer. It's more like a fancy ice bag for the athletes. So right now, our first study is basically going to look at using these cooling devices to see what effect it has on brain temperature monitoring in athletes. And if it does have an effect, what role can we play in using that for the prognosis and putting it on athletes after an injury or before an injury happens itself. So that's part of the first part of the project. And then we start looking at evaluating better assessment tools that we can develop is the second phase. One of the hardest things when evaluating athletes for concussion is they use one standardized test right now that's subjective to me asking you certain questions, where as an athlete, you may be able to say, I feel fine, or I can point a finger and do certain things. One of the tests that we want to try to design, maybe part with virtual reality, some of the biomarkers pre and post, is take it out of the athlete's hand, do more biological aspects. So everything is based on having a baseline and then after an injury, taking that assessment into consideration. These are some of the things that we're trying to collect data on. It's not just us. I'm part of a bigger group, which is the Big Ten Ivy League Consortium. That's the collaboration of researchers, athletic trainers, medical doctors who have come together to try to figure out how to deal with and come up with better assessment tools, better diagnosis tools, so we can start being able to diagnose what type of hits, what type, how long this person was out versus how long this person out. Do genetics play a role in this? Are certain biomarkers being expressed after a head injury that we know gives us a symptoms diagnosis? Being able to follow these athletes may give us a better understanding of how to deal with concussions, because that's one of the biggest issues we have right now is what do you really do with a concussion when a person has one besides sit them out and cognitive rest?
Can we get a look at player 21?
We're not just protecting them to say we're going to get you back out in 7 days, but we're looking at long-term prognosis, long-term health. We want these athletes to be healthy, and that's the biggest part that I want to make sure of is saying, hey, I know you want to play. I've been there. I've done that, but you have to think of safety first for yourself, being aware that these are long-term complications and not just short-term things. And by me being a part of this, I want them to see that I'm not just a person who's a researcher. I'm also a person who's been where you've been, trying to help you not just be a better athlete, but be a better person so you protect yourself in all facets of life, whether it's, you know, academically, whether it's physically, whether it's mentally, that you have some type of way of protecting yourself.